Hopefully everyone can hear me. Okay, cool. Yeah, you can. So today I get to share one of my biggest passions with you, and that is WebAssembly. And as you mentioned, I work at a company called This Dot. I used to work at Netflix before that, and I'm also on the W3C community group for WebAssembly, part of the specification process, and so it really is almost an obsession of mine. So This Dot, in case any of you haven't heard, we do lots of podcasts, trainings, but we also do support contracts, we do developer relations, we do mentorship and workshops, all sorts of stuff. So if any of that stuff's interesting, either reach out to me or reach out to my co-founder, Tracy Lee. So let's get started. What is WebAssembly? Well, it's also known as WASM or WASM, depending on what part of the country you're from. I prefer WASM, personally. And it's an efficient low-level bytecode for the web. That's the quick elevator pitch spiel. So what? Let's kind of unpack that and break that down. What do I mean by efficient? Well, I mean fast to load and fast to execute. Fast to load as in fast to send over the wire through the internet, fast to parse, fast to just-in-time compile to machine code, and then fast once that machine code is actually executing. So it's fast all around is the goal of WebAssembly. And part of that goal has to do with something called streaming compilation. And this means that the bytes, as they're being downloaded into the browser, can be compiled as it's going. It doesn't have to wait until the entire file finishes. And that's huge, because JavaScript, that is the case. In JavaScript, it has to wait until the entire file has finished downloading, then it can start to parse, then it can start to compile or interpret. So I made a little visualization here. I've got this mobile browser in the middle. We've got a WebAssembly file here on the side, and we're going to compile that to machine code as it's being downloaded through the internet. So as a chunk is moving along, it's being compiled to machine code. And you'll notice that, I'm gonna run that one more time, you'll notice that before the next chunk is even finished downloading, we've already compiled the WebAssembly to machine code. So that's huge. That's one of the big reasons why WebAssembly is going to be faster to startup times. But it's also that low-level bytecode. What do I mean by bytecode? Well, it's a series of instructions. It's a virtual machine. So it's just like machine code, except for it's a virtual machine. It abstracts away the actual low-level machine. This is the add instruction, the hexadecimal representation. So WebAssembly itself is very, very low-level. It runs in that virtual machine. And because of that, it's intended as a compilation target. You're not going to be writing WebAssembly by hand unless you want to, just like you wouldn't normally write assembly by hand unless you want to for performance reasons or something like that. So you're gonna take something like this, this is a C or C++, that's going to then get compiled to the bytecode on the right. The most popular question when I talk about WebAssembly is this gonna kill JavaScript, right? You know, we've got some people that love JavaScript, some people that hate it. They're saying, is this our savior? Is it going to kill JavaScript? And the real simple explanation is no, it's not intended to kill JavaScript. It probably isn't going to kill JavaScript. But certainly, maybe in the very long-term future, some other languages will become more dominant than JavaScript, but that's a really tall order. That's a ways out. And so in the short term, what it's going to do is give us a better primitive for compilation targets, right? So right now, C++'s or the Reason and all that stuff, what do? They compile to JavaScript, and JavaScript is a terrible compilation target. So WebAssembly is really going to give us that ability to have these other first-class languages. But if WebAssembly is so fast, are we going to compile our JavaScript to WebAssembly? Can we just shortcut things and have a better performance? Well, the answer to that is super complicated and nuanced. JavaScript is an extremely dynamic language. And I'm saying JavaScript as in the entire specification of ECMAScript. So like here's, I think Brandon's actually in the audience here, but this is a perfect example of JavaScript's dynamic features. The fact that it uses prototype inheritance, and then you can do stupid things like this. You can call the push method on the prototype and totally bork every single array that you'll create from then on out. And there's JavaScript's full of these accidental whoops or just weird quirks and stuff like that. This is JavaScript. Love it or hate it, JavaScript's a great language, but this is JavaScript. And so when someone says, I can compile JavaScript to WebAssembly, I ask them about things like this. Now, Certainly, so fully spec compliant JavaScript, compiling it to WebAssembly would be slower. You'd have to ship either your own very expensive runtime, or you'd have to ship your own virtual machine. And the browsers are really, really great at that. So don't do that. But there is a strict subset of JavaScript that you could compile to WebAssembly. And that could mean either a custom language. There's things like TurboScript, AssemblyScript. These are languages, brand new languages, that are designed with the idea of everyone in this room knows JavaScript, so maybe they can write a subset of JavaScript and then compile that to WebAssembly. But there's also some interesting experiments. Sebastian, one of the Facebook employees who works on both React and a project called Prepack, just the other day asked, what if you could ahead of time compile JavaScript to native machine code or WebAssembly without a runtime or GC? And it's a little bit, you know, like clickbaity in the sense of, again, it's not all of JavaScript, but Prepack, one of their experimental projects, is doing just that. They're if you wrote code a very strict way, a very subset of JavaScript way, they can detect those things. They can detect the types, detect the safety, detect that you don't need garbage collection. You know, you do all stack allocations, and they can compile that to WebAssembly. That's, you know, kind of an edge case-y thing, though, right? You're not going to be taking Lodash and compiling all of Lodash to WebAssembly, at least for now. And that's the main reason is that the V1 of WebAssembly, the MVP, is best suited towards languages like C++ and Rust. These are low-level system languages with not a lot of syntactic sugar in the grand scheme of things. Like basically, that syntactic sugar just compiles all the way to just loads and stores of numbers inside linear memory. There's no garbage collection, it's all manual memory management. So, but other languages are absolutely a goal of WebAssembly. We're taking the incremental approach where we focus on one particular target, get what they need, and then move on. And I think that that's really important so that we don't have another like ES 2015 situation where we have to wait like 11 years for a release. So we're incrementally doing things. But I would say this is the big reason why everyone in this room probably isn't like, oh, I'm super excited for WebAssembly is simply because we're taking an incremental approach. You know, you haven't started using it yet just because most of you probably don't write Rust. Most of you probably don't write C++. But I think even if you don't want to do those things, WebAssembly will be very important to you in the coming years. So right now, when should you target WebAssembly? What is it useful for at the moment? And that's really heavy CPU-bound computations of numbers. And you'd be surprised what actually is effectively a computation of number. The most obvious things are games, right? There's tons of physics, there's tons of pixels, all that type of stuff. WebAssembly is beautiful for that. And in fact, the Unity and Unreal Engine game engines both have WebAssembly as a target, and then it targets WebGL as well. But there's also some other interesting use cases, like porting existing desktop apps that are these C++ code bases. With a little bit of effort, you can actually do that. AutoCAD being a perfect example. It's a huge code base. And they ported their rendering engine and all that stuff to WebAssembly just with their C++ code base. Very, very cool. But if that doesn't excite you, I did want to bring up something that almost every single person in this room is probably already using WebAssembly, and you don't even know it. And that's the source map package. So if you use Create React App, if you use Babel, if you use Less, if you use Firefox, if you use all these other projects that does any kind of source map stuff, that actually is using WebAssembly. The Mozilla folks, they ported their JavaScript implementation to Rust, and then compiled that Rust to WebAssembly, and they saw an over 10x, almost 11x improvement in speed. And I don't know about you, but my build times are really slow, so I really, really appreciate a 10x improvement on source maps. So I think that's really cool. It's super early, and already there are real-world use cases for it. But these other use cases that will really permeate and everyone will love are imminent. They're coming along. So I want to kind of take a step back just a little bit and see, you know, go back. What was that binary stuff we were talking about? I know a lot of you are probably like, all I do is JavaScript. I don't ever deal with binary. Like, you're looking at that and you're going, what the, like, Jay, this talk's boring. I don't understand it. Like, this is just, and like, binary can be a little intimidating. And the pro tip is not to worry about it. I don't look at that binary and go, oh, it's like the Matrix. I see it. I know all the code, you know? Like, that's not how it works. Certainly, you know, you can sometimes remember certain instructions, but no. The goal is tooling is going to make this a non-issue. If you've ever written a native application before, like iOS, Android, what have you, did you have to look at machine code? No. right? And hopefully. and that's because tooling made that a non-issue. And while WebAssembly is not there yet, there's still some holes and gaps, and sometimes you have to peek under the covers and fix some things, tooling will eventually make WebAssembly it's an implementation detail that you won't have to worry about. But until that time, there is a textual representation of that binary. There's an assembly language for assembly, so a textual representation. And it looks like this. So this is that textual representation of the WebAssembly we saw before. So you may be looking at that going, okay, I see if, I see return. This makes a little bit more sense, but I still have no idea what's going on. So let's actually take a second, learn the fundamentals of how WebAssembly actually works. And to do that, we really need to understand that WebAssembly is a stack machine language. So it runs in a virtual machine, and it's a stack machine. Well, what the heck is a stack machine? Well, just so we're clear, a stack is a data structure in which there's only two operations. You can either push or you can pop, and that's it. So you can push things onto a stack, or you can pop it off the stack from the top. And that's the only thing you can do on a stack. So a stack machine is going to be a machine in which the instructions are pushed and popped off of an implicit stack. So let's look at a really simple example, 1 + 2. In the textual representation, the representations of the text version of an instruction is called a mnemonic, or an opcode mnemonic. And so this is on the left, the int32, a 32-bit integer, adding them together. That's the textual representation of the instruction on the right. So the textual representation for 1 + 2 is simply this, 1, 2, add. So let's actually have our little virtual machine on the side here. If the machine started to execute this code, it would say, okay, 1, I'm gonna put that on the stack. 2, I'm gonna put that on the stack. Notice it goes on top. And then it sees the opcode add. And so the add knows I'm going to take the two recent arguments off the stack, so it pops those off. Somehow magically the machine decides, okay, I'm gonna add those together, makes it 3, and then pushes the result back onto the stack again. And that implicit stack is part of the machine itself. That's how it works. There are no registers. So if I wanted to then log the result of that, I just slide a call in there. If there was a log function that took a 32-bit integer, I could just slide a log right under there and that would log it out. So that's the very fundamental basics of WebAssembly. I can't explain all of it because obviously there's a lot to it, but I hope that helps a little bit demystify what the heck, like stack machines and WebAssembly. That's the low-level instructions. But I do want to take a second to say what the heck is missing. Why isn't WebAssembly used by everyone in this room? Why isn't it, you know, super, super popular? And there's a couple things that are missing to really permeate. And the biggest one is going to be direct access to any of the host bindings. So that means things like DOM or the Java, or like things like promises and stuff like that. In WebAssembly, there's no signals, there's no direct access to the host, there's no direct access to the DOM, anything like that. You have to actually go through JavaScript right now. So you have to call JavaScript functions, which then could call the DOM functions, call those type of things. And that actually has a cost. And in certain browsers, a significant cost. And then they're gonna improve the cost of that bridge, but the long-term goal is to have direct access to those host bindings, those DOM and that type of stuff, through WebAssembly without needing JavaScript at all. But it's a pretty complicated thing, and so this is gonna take a while during the spec process and such. The next related thing is garbage collection, right? So if you created a DOM node, okay, great, but it needs to be somehow magically garbage collected, right? What if JavaScript gives a WebAssembly function a DOM node? Now it's inside WebAssembly and it would need to know that. The built-in host garbage collector needs to know about WebAssembly, and that doesn't currently exist. And so that's another very important thing that's required as part of the host bindings thing. But it's also important for languages that are garbage collected, because shipping a garbage collector is actually a whole lot of code for not a whole lot of reason when there's a really great built-in garbage collector already. So exposing that, like languages like Go is actually already has support for WebAssembly and it's garbage collected. But the performance of Go on WebAssembly is actually fairly slow because of the way they had to implement their garbage collector. But that's just a short-term thing. The other thing is multi-threading. Well, a lot of people are really excited about WebAssembly because they'll finally be able to write their C++ code and actually have real, true multi-threading. But this requires something called shared array buffer. And for any of you who knew, many months back when the Spectre and Meltdown exploits happened, they had to disable shared array buffer. So you can't do multi-threading right now in WebAssembly. But Chrome 69 beta, actually, Ken told me I'm supposed to do a shout out to him for Chrome 69 beta. The 69 beta is going to have shared array buffer back enabled, so it's going to be sweet. You'll be able to do your multi-threading. And there's a bunch of more. Like, if you're really interested in the low-level stuff, there's like single instruction, multiple data, or SIMD. That stuff's going to come to WebAssembly. There's going to be a bunch of really cool stuff very specific to it. But I did want to take a second to talk about React itself. How might this impact React? Right now, it doesn't impact it at all, right? React is not using WebAssembly, but how might it in the future? I think it's important to first note that I do not speak for the React core team. I don't. I definitely have talked to them many times, various people, and so I have some ideas of some of the goals, some of the things they've experimented on, but nothing today is an official thing. Don't tweet, you know, React is going to move into WebAssembly, all that stuff. So, but maybe there's a very, I think, in my opinion, high likelihood that eventually there'll be a version of React written in another language. Probably Reason, let's be honest. It'll be written in Reason and compiled to WebAssembly. Once we get those native host bindings, once we get that garbage collection, it'll be a very, very, very cool thing to see. And you'll be able to use that version of React still in JavaScript if you wanted to, but you could also use it in Reason, OCaml, any of the other cool languages. The other thing, and I think this will probably come sooner than that, is React components themselves could be written in WebAssembly. Even if React itself is still written in JavaScript, you can still write your components in WebAssembly. And you're not writing it by hand in WebAssembly, you're gonna use Reason. Like Ken showed earlier, Reason is an amazing language, and it depends on a JavaScript version of React. But Reason will probably target WebAssembly probably within the next couple years. I think that's very, very likely. They've already done some experimentation. Sander Spies, if you want to follow him on Twitter, he's the person who's been doing most of the experimentation on compiling to WebAssembly. But missing that garbage collection and host binding stuff is the biggest blocker at this point. And that being said, this is all possible right now. Like, they could do these things. It could target WebAssembly. It's just slow enough and not effective enough, a file size as well, that it's just not worth it at this point. But that doesn't mean no one is doing this. I did want to give a really, because I'm obsessed with WebAssembly, I have to give a shout out to the Ember team, who's been plowing ahead and experimenting already with their rewriting their Glamour virtual machine in Rust and compiling that to WebAssembly and using some pretty cool tricks to get around the performance issues between calling the bridge. So if you spend most of your time, like if code spends most of its time in WebAssembly itself and only calls over like once per frame or something like that, that's perfectly fine. You won't notice any performance issues because WebAssembly itself is fast. It's the bridge that's slow. So how do I get started? If you are interested in this, even if you're just interested in like just keeping track of it or you want to learn more, the most obvious thing is webassembly.org. But that's going to be pretty low level. Like, it's going to be people who are like compiler authors and stuff like that. If you're interested in just using WebAssembly through tooling and stuff like that, there's Awesome Wasm is probably one of the best resources on the web. It has links to pretty much everything, all the different languages that compile to WebAssembly, lots of blog articles, videos, libraries, all sorts of really cool stuff. And if you're wondering what kind of browser support we have, all the way across the board, supported by every modern browser. Of course, it's not supported by Internet Explorer. And that's, you know, what are you gonna do? I mean, it's never gonna be supported by them. So, I'm talking about browsers, and a lot of people, I would say, focus on WebAssembly when they're talking about what they say, browsers, browsers, browsers. I think that this is actually a revolution. I think WebAssembly is a revolution, and we're gonna go back to that definition, efficient low-level bytecode for the web. I wanna actually look at that last part and say, for the web, well, let's look at the specification of WebAssembly. Where does WebAssembly mention the web or browsers or anything like that? Right here. That's it. This is all it says about browsers. It says it can be embedded in browsers. or it can also run as a standalone virtual machine, or integrated into other environments. WebAssembly is unprecedented. There has never been major corporations coming together and designing a machine bytecode. This never happens. Java, x86, none of these instruction sets have been collectively designed by a bunch of companies together. They're all proprietary, single-use type of things. So this is really unprecedented that an ISA, an instruction set, has been designed by that. And it's important. They knew that from the very beginning, and they decided, we're going to make WebAssembly not specific to browsers. We're going to spec this out as a generic virtual machine bytecode, and other people will and can use it. And there's a kind of an inside joke within the WebAssembly community that WebAssembly is neither web nor assembly, but even though, like, so it's called WebAssembly just because it sounded really hip and stuff, and that's what it was called really early on when it was started to be designed, and then as things progressed, the name stuck, but it's actually not for the web only, and it's not actually an assembly language. It's a bytecode, but whatever, it's okay. So I want to take that definition, I want to scratch that out, because what if, I think it's not too much of a stretch to imagine operating systems that support WebAssembly built in. It's not too much of a stretch to see, heck, Node itself is a perfect example. It supports WebAssembly. Now, in the future, if Node decides to expose some of the host bindings, its own host bindings to WebAssembly itself, now Node actually becomes a really attractive platform just as a virtual machine. It's a really great cross-platform virtual machine that C++ people can use or what have you. I think, WebAssembly just has a ton of potential. And so if that's interesting to you, I ask you if you want to come talk to me and also hit me up on Twitter. So thank you very much for your time. Have a good conference.